love Easter. I do love Easter. There was a couple, and they were there, and was with the fellow's mother-in-law. They went to the Holy Land, but when they were there, his mother-in-law passed away. And that was a bit unfortunate, but, you know, he was a bit of a cranky mother-in-law, you know. So does anybody have a cranky mother-in-law? Johnny, stop. I don't have a cranky mother-in-law either, but this fella did. And she passed away there in the Holy Land. So they went to an undertaker, and the undertaker said, you know, it's going to cost $5,000 to send her back home. He said, but you know what? Wouldn't it be an amazing privilege for her to be buried here in the Holy Land? He says, and you know what? I'd only charge you $150. $150. He's like, wow, that is a good deal. He said, let me think about it for a second. And he went, no. We're going to send her back home. I don't understand. I know how much your mother-in-law loved the Holy Land. And I mean, she'd love to be buried. He says, I thought about it, though, when I heard a few thousand years ago somebody was buried here and died. And 3 days later, they rose up again. So I'm not taking any chances. You know, so. Oh, thank you. Thank you. They're not always good, but that was all right. Even, unless you're a mother-in-law. Who's a mother-in-law today? Let me pray for you. All right, praise. You're probably a good mother-in-law, though, right? Amen. Amen. Hey, Easter. John chapter 20. John chapter 20 starts with Mary, and Mary is running to the grave there, and she gets there, and she wants to see if she can anoint Jesus' body, because the burial and everything that took place, it all happened rather quickly, and she really wanted to make sure that his body was saturated and covered with these beautiful ointments. And, you know, this was somebody who completely transformed her life. This was someone who had a very difficult life. I mean, had 7 demons cast out of her. Her life was a total mess, and yet she met somebody who didn't just set her free, but gave her a sense of dignity, even as a woman. I mean, she was allowed to travel with them, be a part of a ministry team, and it gave such significance to her life, even in a time when women, I mean, it said that men, if they had to choose their cow or their wife, choose your cow. It was really a strange, strange culture, but women were such a second or not even third. They were somewhere else on the rung, and yet this woman, this teacher had so radically touched her life. So she ran to the tomb, and when she got there, the tomb was open, and he was gone. And so she ran back and she told Peter and John. And then it says that Peter and John began to run. And John wrote the book, but John wanted to make it clear that he ran faster than Peter. So he ran faster than Peter, but he stood at the tomb and he looked in and it was empty. But when Peter got there, Peter went all the way inside. And a very interesting verse is this verse right here. It says, then Simon Peter came following him, and he went into the tomb, and he saw the linen cloths lying there and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. But folded together in a place by itself. And Scripture made this clear to us. Scripture took a whole verse to point out that the cloth, the handkerchief, the linen veil that would have been over his face, it was taken and it was laid folded neatly by itself. Everything else was strewn around, but that, some translations call it a handkerchief. They use different names for it, but that's that linen cloth was folded neatly and put down on its own. And so I think that's significant. I looked it up and I studied a few different things. In all kinds of places, I saw that what that means in a Hebrew culture, if a master was eating at his table and if he tossed in his napkin, that meant the servants can come and remove everything from the table. But if he neatly folded his napkin, that meant, I'm not done yet. I'm not done yet. And I think even these guys, steeped in Hebrew culture, as they looked in the tomb, they saw something, and they pointed it out. It was of interest. It was worth writing in Holy Scripture for all eternity that the cloth was folded on its own, neatly placed by itself. And I think what we can deduct from that, he's not done yet. He's not done yet. He's not done yet. I love Andrew Murray. Andrew Murray said this, great books, great teachings on prayer, but Andrew Murray said, a dead Christ I must do everything for. A dead Christ I must do everything for. A dead Christ was just a teacher, somebody who modeled something, someone who was a moralist. He said, but if it was just somebody who died, then he did these teachings that I must now conform my life to. I must align myself with those teachings. He said, a dead Christ, I must do everything for. But he said, a living Christ does everything for me. I love how extreme that is. It doesn't say a living Christ helps me. It doesn't say a living Christ opened doors for me. I love the way he says that. A living Christ does everything for me. Isn't that great? You know, that is the story of Easter, that he has done everything for us, and he's going to attend to every single detail. He's going to enforce that amazing victory. He's going to enforce his resurrection in every aspect of our lives. Amen. He does everything for me. John chapter 19, verse 30, when Jesus had tasted it, the wine vinegar was shoved to his mouth. And when he had tasted it, he said, it is finished. It is finished. Literally, that is a word that you would use if you went to the market and you bought, you know, some stuff, some bread, some things. If you went to the market and you said, thank you for that. If you bought it and you purchased it, they would give you a bill and the bill would say, paid in full. Jesus used that word to say, done everything necessary. I have paid it in full. It is all covered. It is finished. It is done. And you know what? If I bought something at the store and they came after me and said, hey, sir, do you have the receipt for that? I could pull it out and go, I do. I purchased it. It's mine. Get off my back. You see, but we have the receipt. We have the receipt. And you know what the receipt is? He's risen. He's risen. It says that in Romans chapter 4, verse 20, I believe it is. It says that our sins are forgiven because of the cross, but we are made righteous because of the resurrection. And the resurrection is my receipt that everything he said is true, and it is finished indeed, and I am absolutely set free. So he said it is finished, then he bowed his head and he released the Spirit. Now, Revelation chapter 21. Fabulous, fabulous scripture, because it talks about when the new heavens and the new earth come and the whole new creation comes and he's fulfilled everything. Here he says, and he said to them, it is done. Some translations say it is finished, but it's a totally different word than the word used in John. It's a different word. See, he said it is finished there, but now he's going to say it is done. So what we know there is, and it is finished, but we also await the Savior to say another phrase, which is, it is done. And he hasn't said it is done yet. When there's a new heaven and a new earth, it descends out of heaven, a new Jerusalem. When he's made all things new and the new creation is in full manifestation, then Jesus is going to say, it is done. So it is finished, but he's not done yet. It is finished. But he's not done yet. It's finished, but I'm not done yet. I will still be working towards a specific end. Jesus is alive today to bring into manifestation his new creation. Isn't that great? So you could have somebody who dies who has a will, and their will should be honored. But you know, the will could be contested, and other people could mess with it, people could fight over that will. But it's a beautiful thing when the one who made the will, the one who died to put it in force, is also alive to make sure that every detail is attended to. So now if everybody tries to contest that or come against that, Jesus is alive to enforce everything that his resurrection has won for us. The resurrection has incredible benefits for you and for me. I got an amen from the front row. I got a good over on the side. I got a giggle in the second row. Mark chapter 16, verse 20 says, and they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them. And they went out and they preached everywhere, the Lord working with them. I think sometimes we think it is finished. He sat down. He's up there. We're down here. And I know he sent the Spirit. And I know he's flooded us and saturated with that power from on high. But you know what? Jesus also is fully engaged today to bring into manifestation everything his resurrection means. Isn't that great? And the Lord was working with them. He was confirming the word through accompanying signs. Amen. Wednesday night, we had a leadership meeting, and Wayne clearly struck by the three C's, the clarity, the curiosity, and the courage. I just pray that we would have clarity today. Even as we're moving into this new location, I pray that we would have the kind of clarity we need to see why God's doing this with us. But then I want you to have curiosity. I want you to open your heart to something brand new. I believe God wants to do things that have never been done before. He may want us to minister in ways that have never been done before. He may want to do a new thing. Do you perceive it? And I said, I want you to have curiosity, but then I want you to have the courage to be boldly just going into that because I believe God is doing something new. But as I was sharing with them, I said, you know, I've preached a million times the Great Commission, but you know what? It is a commission. It's not the Great Mission. Here's a great mission for you guys. It's the commission. It's the mission where the Lord is working with us. And we are a part of something where he is yoked with us, doing incredible things in our day. And I'm telling you, it's going to get better and better. It's going to get gooder and gooder. I tell you, it's not going to be, there's not going to be a more wonderful time in the church than there is today. Because God is always doing exceedingly abundantly. God is always releasing himself in greater ways. There's always more going on in the kingdom. So we should believe for better and better. What's he doing? Let me tell you what the resurrected Christ is doing. And this is just what the resurrected Christ did back then. At the resurrection, when Mary was there at the tomb weeping, and she turned and she thought it was a gardener, and she said to him, she said, where did you take my Savior? Where did you put him? And there he was, the Christ, the one who created all things with his voice, spoke everything into creation, the gardener. He was there, and he said, don't touch me, I haven't ascended yet. But he turned and he said, Mary, and she recognized that was her Savior. So you know what he's doing? When you feel like your life is broken, when you feel like all your dreams are gone, when you feel like the most significant thing that happened to me is just blown up in my face, Jesus shows up at that moment, and he says, Mary. You know, he'll never leave you, never forsake you. He's going to work with you in every circumstance or situation. If you're here this Easter, you know anybody in your world or in your family this Easter, Jesus is still working. He's not done yet, because wherever there's brokenness or there's incomplete dreams or realities in your world, believe that God is at work for you, and he's at work in you, and he's going to finish what he started for you. Amen. Amen. Then there's Peter, right? I mean, Peter completely denied Christ. He just walked away from the whole thing. He went off fishing, but I love that he showed up. It says, go and tell the disciples and Peter. Go and tell the disciples and Peter. Aren't you glad he does that? You know, I mean, that was a big deal that he brought up the name Peter, because he knew Peter has got to be a broken mess right now, but I'm not going to leave that situation like that. I'm not going to leave that situation where it is. I'm going to make sure that Peter is fully restored. So God is restoring lives. I love the two guys on the road to Emmaus. Emmaus means hot springs. They were going for a hot bath. And I love what it says. They were doing a 7-mile journey from Jerusalem, and in the middle there, they're talking and they're questions. In the middle of their journey, they're talking, and they were walking away from Jerusalem. They were shattered by the events that had taken place. When Jesus got up with them, they said, what are you talking about? How do you not know what we're talking about? I mean, what happened in Jerusalem this weekend? Everybody knows what happened. It didn't happen in a little corner. Everybody, how can you not know what happened? And Jesus is like, tell me about it. But you see, they had questions. You're allowed to have questions. You know, we've been told, don't have any questions. Stop questioning things. Just believe, brother. Hallelujah. Just believe. You know, but they who'd been with Jesus, they'd been with him. They'd seen what he had done. But when he was crucified, when he died, that whole thing shattered their world to such a degree that they turned their back and they began to walk away. And you know what I need? I need a hot bath and some candles, maybe some salts or something. Amen. How many like those kind of baths? I don't like baths, but anyways. But a hot tub's always good. They were like, I just need comfort. But you know what? When you feel shattered, you don't understand. When you got questions, does anybody have questions? Like, honestly, you ever had a question? Why is Arsenal playing so poorly? Like, honest to goodness, Anyways, that's one of my questions, not relevant today, but anyways. But you know, I have questions. I don't know, but you'll go through experiences, you have questions. And I don't want to be a part of a group that says don't question anything. I want to be a part of a group where bring your questions, bring your problems, and your Bible. And you know what? God's not afraid of questions. Jesus isn't afraid if you have questions. If you're concerned and you've got questions and you're walking away, you know what he does? He catches up with you in the middle of the question and says, hey, let's talk about it. Let me journey with you. Let me help you with clear revelation of who I am. Has anybody changed their mind about anything in the last 5 years? Has anybody, even your revelation of God or the way you thought it all worked out, has any of that changed in the last 5 years? Not me. I've believed the same way for 31 years. Nothing changed ever. You know, there's times where I've gone through things and God has revealed himself to me more clearly in some ways. I'm like, wow, I used to think this. But I'm so glad that on my journey, in the middle of my questions, he caught up with me. And he addressed those things. And then he was revealed in the breaking of the bread. It says, didn't our hearts burn as they began to expound to us and tell us what's going on? What's going on? You know, he is in the middle right now of restoring lives. If you've got questions, you got hurts, you got disappointments, you got pains, you've literally feel like you walked away from him, you feel shattered and broken, he is going to catch up with you, and he's still working to bring you into the full expression of everything that he's called you to. Amen, amen, amen. That was one. No, I got two. You know, it says I get 8 points here, but somewhere I skipped one. There's only seven. Say praise the Lord. Amen, all right. He walks through locked doors. I love this. Because here's the disciples. They're like, oh, you know, they don't know where Jesus is. They're going to say that we stole his body. I mean, the soldiers are going to be coming for us. I mean, these women, they're a bit crazy, but, you know, they said that they saw him. He's risen. Oh, my goodness. I mean, what's going on? And they're locked in behind these doors, terrified of their lives. And all of a sudden, boo. He didn't say boo. I don't think so. But how many know if you're behind a locked door and somebody walks through the wall? That'd be a bit of a boo, wouldn't it? Yeah. I always wondered if he can walk through locked doors, if he can walk through walls, what holds him up? Anyways, he walks through walls, but he stands on floors. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe you've never thought about that, but I thought, wow. Anyway, you know, when you're in a locked door, anybody ever been in a locked door? You've been in a situation where you're locked down, where life has put you in a place of anxiety, of panic, and of fear. There's things going on in your life, maybe an attack on a family member. You got sickness, you got things attacking your body, and you're just like, man, I've moved all the way from questions to straight out locked doors. I feel I am in an impossible situation, and man, I'm shut down. There's nothing, there's no one that can help me. If you're right there right now, Jesus walks through locked doors. Isn't that great? What's he doing? He's walking through locked doors. He's walking through situations that seem impossible. He is risen. He is risen. That is the proof that we are righteous. That is the proof that he has walked through every locked situation, and he is the one who brings life. He walks through locked doors. He performs miracles. I love this. The risen Christ. The risen Christ. I love this story because Peter said, let's go fishing. Peter's shattered. Peter's like, I can't believe I did what I did. I'm brokenhearted. I'm so shattered that I told Jesus I'd be there for him, and I walked away from him. So he decided to go fishing. So he's up in Galilee fishing. Well, I'll tell you what, even if you've wandered away and you've decided I'm not going to do this anymore, he even catches up with you there. Isn't that great? And here's a really great thing is I love that the resurrected Christ, he was there, and he called forth a whole bunch of cooking angels, and they came out of heaven, and they made a beautiful buffet breakfast. No, the resurrected Christ made breakfast. The resurrected Christ started a fire. I am the King of Glory. The King of Glory made breakfast for these guys who had wandered away from their calling. And he's like, you know what? I'm going to do something great. We're going to hang out after. I'm going to cook some breakfast. Then he goes, hey, you guys, you got any fish? And of course, Peter, worst fisherman ever. Please show me anywhere in the scripture where Peter ever caught a fish. I mean, I can't believe he was actually a fisherman. He took over dad's business and he couldn't catch a thing. But he says, hey, you guys got any fish? And no, we haven't got anything. But then Jesus says, throw your net on the right side. You know what? One time, we were at the old building and we were just starting to renovate the other side. And we'd actually just decided what we're going to do is we're going to move some speakers over and some chairs, and it's not done. It's a concrete floor and just a warehouse, and there's no walls or anything yet, but we're going to just put ourselves there. I just want people to see, because the library moved out, and we were ready to take it over. I said, I just want to get over there and do it, you know? And so we set it all up, took all night, set it up, and then I went home Saturday night and said, now I got to dream up a sermon. And I almost fell off my chair, because right away the Lord said, cast your net on the right side. He just spoke to me like a verbal thing. It hit me so hard, it almost knocked me off my chair. And I went, that's in the Bible somewhere. You know, he said, cast your net on the right side. And for me, when you come to the building and you get to the main doors, the right side was the new area we were moving into. And the Lord spoke to me, he says, cast your net on the right side. You might have done this just to kind of give people a vision of where you're headed, but I want you to go there and I want you to stay there. Don't go back. Cast your net on the right side. And I preached the whole sermon about casting your net on the right side and how we'd get a miraculous haul. And you know, we never went back. We didn't have any money to carpet the place. We didn't have any money to finish building the platform. But when we were there that day, I got two calls that afternoon of people who wanted to give us money to carpet the whole place, finish the platform. We're in there. Let's stay there. And I went, praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. You know? So good, I'm telling you. He is still a God who performs miracles. He's still performing, and God worked with them, confirming the word with signs, and we got a belief for miracles. He was there. Cast your net on the right side. Cast your, whatever's going on in your life, I mean, talk to Jesus. Just talk to him for a minute. He's got a miracle for you. Your life is a miracle every day. Don't settle for average and status quo. Believe that you are co-missioning with a God who wants to make your life unexplainable and demonstrate great things through you. Can I get an amen? Amen. It's a terrible thing when we are children of Almighty God and our lives are altogether too explainable. Number four, he's still pouring out his spirit. He's still pouring out his spirit. It said that this Jesus, whom God has raised up, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear. Hey! He's still pouring out his spirit. You know, you read through the book of Acts, you'll see several times, and the spirit was poured out again, and the spirit was poured out again, and sometimes it was on people who'd already been baptized in the spirit. They got a fresh filling of the Holy Ghost. You know what? Jesus can't contain himself. He's constantly pouring out and pouring out and pouring fresh anointings on you. He's ministering his goodness, his glory, his power, and his majesty. He's still pouring out his spirit. The resurrected Christ is liberally releasing upon you fresh anointing of power, of grace, and goodness to do everything he's called you to do. True story. He's still building his church. He's building his church. I love that. Acts chapter 5, and he said, who are you, Lord? Now here's a guy who didn't believe in Jesus, who had literally been killing Christians and trying to put this thing down once and for all, and yet here's the resurrected Christ. He's already risen. He's already risen, but he's still at work. Here's the resurrected Christ. Years later, here he is showing up on the road to Damascus, knocking Paul right off his horse. And he says, who is it, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus. I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the goads. Now, a goad is what you would use if you had an ox cart and you want the ox to hurry up. You poke, poke. What that means is that God had been trying to get through for a long time. You've been resisting. You've been resisting the goats. You've been resisting the provoking. You've been resisting the act of the Spirit of God in your life. But finally, Jesus said, boom, knocked him off his horse. Said, you, sir, are going to be my apostle to the Gentiles. I'm going to use you to establish my church in the Gentile world. You know, Jesus is still building his church. You know, Jesus showed up on a rooftop when Peter was there, and he had a vision of all these unclean animals. And Jesus showed up, and he said, eat. And he said, no, Lord. No, imagine that. No, Lord. But then the Lord said, don't you dare call unclean what I have called holy. He's trying to give him a vision that you literally are a bigot. Peter, you think that this faith is only for your little group of people. And he said, don't ever call unclean what I have called clean. And he wanted to break off his mindset. You see, folks, we got to get broken off our mindset. See, sometimes the church thinks that Jesus only came for the people we agree with or the people we like or the people who see the world like I do. You know, there's a lot of people. See, Peter didn't think the Gentiles, even after that vision, he went and preached to Cornelius' house, and the Holy Spirit fell on the Gentiles, and they were all shocked. Said the Holy Spirit fell on them just like he fell on us. He was so shocked, they had to have a whole council of leaders to say, what are we going to do about the Gentile problem? Who's the problem today in your world? Who's the problem in your eyes? What's the group of people that you think are the, yeah, no, not them. The Lord would never touch that. Where is it in society where you think that's the untouchable in my world? Hey, Jesus wants to break that off, and he's still working today. He's still building his church. He's still breaking mindsets off of us. The church, you know, Billy Graham said the greatest force of evangelism is the church. He said the greatest farce of evangelism is the church. Sadly, when we think about what people think about the church, where did they get that from? Now, we got to manifest, you know, don't you dare call unclean what he has called holy. And every single person that you meet has been formed and shaped in the image of God. Every one of them designed to be a container of His holiness. Every single one of them worthy of His life, worthy of His goodness, and worthy of His grace. And I want to see all kinds of people. I want to see the whosoever wills come into the knowledge that He's a good God and He loves you with an everlasting love. You've never lived an unloved moment. He's always been for you. Whatever you've heard from the church or whatever the church has done or whatever's happened in your life, we need the church to be the safest place in the world, the most loving place in the world, the most tender place in the world, most incredible place in the world. Amen. So Jesus is still building His church. You know, Jesus today is still releasing gifts. It says Jesus, when He who descended, ascended, then He gave gifts of human beings. And He's still releasing in the body of Christ ministries today to bring His church to full, absolute formation. That's by Jesus. That's by Jesus. He's still building His church. Acts chapter 2, verse 47, it said, and the Lord, it says the Lord. It doesn't say that the people made some phone calls and made people come. It says, and the Lord added to the church daily those who are being saved. What's the resurrected Christ doing? He's still commissioning with us. He's still working with us. He's still building His church. And He's still reaching out to people. And the Lord is going to continue to add to the kingdom. No, He's going to add to the church. Jesus is building His church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. The church. Tell you, the church, shaking's going to happen in the church. Stuff going to go on in the church. But there is a church coming forth. There's a church in power and purity and beauty. But open about our problems. Open about our brokenness. Honest about life. Not smug and self-righteous. But walking in the freedom of knowing that, but for the grace of God, go I. A place where you can feel loved, you can feel accepted, and you can come. That's the kind of church that Jesus is adding people to. He still has the keys. Man, you got any keys? Who's got keys? I love that He's got the keys. Look, you got keys. You got keys. Carly got keys. You got more keys. Carly's got more keys. She got more stuff. I don't know if there's keys there, but you got more stuff. Man, you got two vehicles. You got two cars. That's so good. You got any keys? If you got keys, pull your keys out just for fun. You know, keys are important. Now, if you're going to give your keys to somebody, what are you saying? You're saying, be careful, okay? I trust you. When you give somebody keys, you're giving them authority. When you give them keys, you're giving them access. When you give them keys, you're giving them responsibility. You see, but Jesus said, I am He who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I am the one who died, was buried, but now I'm resurrected. I am the risen Christ. Amen. So be it. And I have the keys to Hades and to death. I tell you, whatever's going on in your world, He's got the keys. Whatever's going on, He now has the authority. And you know what it says? And I have given you the keys to the kingdom. And you know what? When you have keys, it means you can open up and you can lock up. And it says, Jesus said, I've given you that responsibility that whatever you bind is bound and whatever you loose is loose. He says, I've got the keys and I'm sharing these things with you. So we're not only restored, you know, blessed and we can ask questions and all the rest of it. He's also given responsibility that we literally get to bind and loose. We get to allow and disallow. We get to determine what's really going on because we got the keys. Man. Oh, sorry, I just gave your cars away. There he's. All right, there you go. He still got the keys. Revelation 3:7, He opens and no one shuts. He shuts and no one opens. Listen, when you become a child of God, nobody can do anything about that. He's got the keys to that. He's got the authority over that. When you become a child of God, He's the one who turned that key in your life. You couldn't make yourself righteous. He made you righteous. You cannot undo what He did. You cannot lock up what He has unlocked. You cannot shut the door to what He has opened. And He's opened to you a highway of blessing, of holiness, of privilege. And He's done all of that because He has the keys. If He has the keys, He has the authority. And He has the authority to bless you, to transform things, and bring it all into manifestation in your life. Number 7. I know it says 8, but I somewhere skipped a number. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. Well, I'm just into this religion for, you know, just doing something as I'm passing through. He's coming back again. Josie's got keys. He's coming back again. And behold, right here in the end of Revelation says, and behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work as it shall be. I am the Alpha. I am the Omega. I am the beginning. I am the end. I am the first and the last. Oh, hasten your coming, King Jesus. Don't you long for his coming? See, a lot of times they use his coming as a scare tactic that Jesus is coming back. You better look busy. Hey, that's Pastor Zach. If you're not reading Pastor Zach's Thursday blogs, I don't know what's wrong with you. You really need to because they're really, really good. But he talked about a t-shirt. I bought one in Mexico. I love it. I went to this beach store and it says Jesus is coming back soon. Everybody look busy. I thought that's great. I put it on. It looked good. I might still have it. I don't know. I think Cheryl might have. Maybe not. Okay. But you know, aren't you excited at the fact? It's not a scary thing that Jesus is coming back because he loves you. He's for you. And I tell you, things are going to get a whole lot better. Things are going to be totally transformed. He says, I'm going to wipe away every tear. I'm going to make all things new. He's going to bring into full expression his new creation. Who doesn't want some of that? Man. John chapter 11, 25 and 26 from the Message. It says, you don't have to wait for the end. You don't have to wait for the end. You don't have to wait till we're at 1,200 to invite somebody. You don't have to, Jesus could come back tomorrow and you go, oh, sorry. I was going to bring you to church in a few weeks. Sorry, too late. You don't have to wait for the end. You don't have to wait for the end. I am right now resurrection and life. I am right now resurrection and life. I love that. He said that to Martha. He said, Martha, didn't I say that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? Didn't I say if you believe, you will see the glory of God? I am the resurrection and life right now. The one who believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live. And everyone who lives believing in me does not ultimately die at all. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Isn't that great? You see, he's done all the heavy lifting. There's nothing left for him to do for your redemption. Your sins are forgiven. It's done. All of that stuff is finished. Do you believe this? All you have to do is say, oh, that sounds good. I'll align myself with that. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Because it says everyone who believes, it says, will not die, but will live and have that everlasting life. Come on,